.6. Is that right? Is that about 10?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the question might come, at what point, how many wraps would it take that there's so much friction there then that you don't even need any weight on the other end? And if you graph that out, if you graph this equation and just pick some representative coefficient of friction, which I just chose a half, then you get, after about, let's see, so this is number of wraps, and this is T2 over T1, and after about 4 wraps, because of the exponential form of this, goes up like that and very quickly gets to about a ratio of these two of about 200,000. Meaning you can hold 200,000 times more force on the high end than you need on the low end, which is essentially zero, and it explodes well exponentially from there. I think you're ready for a get out of class question. Continuing with our theme, and in fact, it's the follow-up of what happened with this story, because it turns out that there are horse thieves, and they know that you can unwrap this and then take the horse. So, Deadeye McGirt was caught doing exactly that. You guys don't know this lore being Adirondackers, where nothing ever happens. Caught and strung up.
Saratoga Battlefield? It's kind of a big deal.
Yeah, but that was before.
Yeah, they had horses then as well.
What about what happened in Saratoga Battlefield?
They had horses.
No, no. Formation of America.
Oh, that. So, inside the saloon, since they're made out of logs, are two exposed log rafters. Of course, they don't turn, and this whole part here is on non-turning pulleys. And you decide that you need to string him up well. That's your intent. Got the little crosses on his eyes and his tongue's hanging out. That's a sure sign of medical death. If he weighs 200 pounds and the coefficient of friction over the two posts is 0.2 here and 0.4 there, I think there were pigeons on one of them, is why the difference. With what force must you pull here to hold the 200 pounds on the other side?
About 350.
No. So, That's your problem. If you don't hold it enough, then he'll slip. Now, you're not trying to hoist him. Remember, this is a statics class. We're not trying to accelerate things. Assuming he's in the air, With what force must you hold him there? If you don't hold enough, he'll slip. If you pull too much, he'll go up. You'll pull him over this pose, and he'll flop on the ground, and then he can reach his guns again. And he's a crack shot. Mr. Navy, you're on board with this Western tale?
Not in the least bit.
Yes, you are.
It's probably pretty hot outside. The body's going to bloat real fast. That's going to be a lot of variance in what's going to take to hold him there. And he's just going to drop. Horse. What's that?
Just hang to the horse.
Bet you guys are real fun in movies when you sit in the audience and you just correct everybody.
I can usually have it figured out within the first 10 minutes. Yeah. Pretty good.
And then let everybody know.
Yeah. I'll let everybody know.
Because not only is he tweeting to everybody, he's probably just plain shouting it out.
Gets the message across much easier.
Yeah. Now, this has got to be a two-part problem. What you'll need to do is go from here to the tension in the line across there, T sub question mark, and then go from there to the load that you need to hold here. Which is TU, buddy. So that's your get out of class question. And is there advantage for going over two of those rafters instead of one? How much to just hold the load? So you can set this equation up between here and here, and then set it up again between there and here, and without solving for the intermediate value, you can actually combine those and go directly from 1 to 3. If you want. It's not a big deal to solve for that intermediate value, but you can solve straight across for the two of them. Write the two equations, one for two to three, combine them and eliminate two, solve for it directly. You could do that a little messy, couldn't you? Get a sack of flour, some grain, tie it on there, some lead that you were planning on melting down into bullets later.
You like that part, Alan?
And then part B, that's part one. Part B is, that's the load just to hold him from slipping down. What more would you need to pull to just get him to start moving up? Just start pulling up. slightly different problem. And you have to consider kind of carefully what the difference in that's going to be. Got it, Tex? No.
Nope, I don't.
Now, you have to remember, when we set this equation up here, this whole thing was predicated on T2 being greater than T1. If it's the opposite of that, then you have to flip the equation over or flip the forces over. You're going to need to remember that for part B. Taylor's got it already. See what she got that's different than your answer. You get it? Bell? I can't remember all these new names. Not quite. Check your math.
Okay.
Remember, the greater of the forces goes on the top. So we're going to have to set this one up as T1 over T2 equals E to the 0.2. And the angle is 1/4 of a turn. So what's that? Pi over 2 in radians, I believe. And then you can also set up T2 over T3 equals E to the 0.4, also pi over 2. And between the two of those, you can eliminate T2. Just simply multiply them together. That eliminates T2, gives you just one equation. Or you can solve them both. Find T2 and carry it to the second one.
So if you have to find that T2 is the bigger one.
The way we originally set up the equation, yes.
Would it be T2 over T1 equals E?
No.
That's T1 should be on the other side.
Because the force decreases as we go back to here. Because the friction is taking up some of that load. So we have 200 pounds here in the line.
Okay, I see.
We're going to have less here because friction's holding some of it, then even less here because friction's holding even more of it. So when you multiply those, you get T1 over T3 equals E. Remember what happens when you multiply exponents? You add them together. T1 is 200 pounds, and you can solve for T3. Is that what you did, Taylor? Oh, you did find the intermediate one. Just, no trouble, just Taylor happened to find this intermediate one. I didn't have it written down. 146 pounds. The difference being the friction on that first rafter. Got it yet, Nate?
I don't think I know what I'm filling in for T1 and T2.
T1 is 200 pounds.
All right.
And then T2 is unknown, but you can solve for it. And then do the equation again to get T3.
T2 is 146 pounds?
Well, that's not given. That's,
okay.
That's what, if you do the equation from here to here, you'll find it's 146.
All right.
Or you can do, you can multiply these two, set up the two equations, multiply them and eliminate T2.
Because then this is half of that.
And just go right to T3. Notice, if I multiply these two, T2 cancels. I don't have T2 in here, I just go straight over. Either one will work, it just depends on which math steps you prefer to do. But that's our working equation, built with T2 being greater than T1. So for this one, you then go the other way, where T3's got to increase, be greater than T2, be greater than T1, to find the point where you could just start to lift him. So this would be T3 over T2. Now going right to left across the line. And that'll give you a new T2 and a new T1. Notice it's just the inverse of what we had here. Because now, instead of things getting greater going this way, getting less going this way, and they're now getting less going that way for the second part of the problem. You get it? Oh, that's right. After all these years, you still haven't learned.
This is my personal one.
Yep. Well, I don't know if you need to go to a 1/100th of a pound, since his weight 200 pounds is not to 1/100th of a pound. He just kind of weighs that. You know, we put him on the scale, 2 sacks of flour and a heifer calf. See what came up. Got it? You still discontented with the integration?
No, that's what I'm trying
to do. And I took calculus 40 years ago. I don't think it's changed that much. Books have changed, now they have color in them. Okay, I will. Now you can do it back the other way. Multiplying those two, you can solve for T1. Solve for T3 is what we're looking for. T1 doesn't change, because that's the load. But for this one, now you need to increase T3 enough to overcome the friction there, overcome the friction there, and get to the point where you just start to raise the load. Not to the point where we're actually accelerating it, of course, that's not this class. But just to the point where the load starts to then move. Because you're worried about his sidekick, Shorty, coming in. So you got to raise the load a little bit higher so Shorty can't get his boots. John gave up. Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot more, isn't it? You're going to need some help with that one. So for the first one, you should have gotten 78 pounds just by solving for T3 here.
I think my calculator's broken. It's that's just not getting it. The right answers.
Not getting this?
No, yeah, I'm not. It comes out to...
Oh, yeah. Is it phaser notation?
Phaser notation.
No.
Is that it?
It's not?
Cool.
Oh, yeah. It would put the E into something else.
Yeah, because it would change the E.
Taylor, did you figure out T2 on this one, or did you just do it directly to T3?
I figured out T2 on that one.
What was it? So, you said that 278?
74.
274. And T3 comes out, Taylor got it, to 513. So, to lift a 200-pound load, you need 2.5 times that force to overcome the friction that's there on the... as the belt runs over the rafters, the rope runs over the rafters. You wouldn't use a belt, that'd be kind of dumb.
Yeah, because I didn't get the 78, all I got was the 513.
You didn't get the 78 here. Put 200 in there.
I did that.
And then solve for T3. And Jared, I think that's a wrap.
All right, I got that.
Got the 78 now? Okay.
Yep.
You do have to.